This week, not without danger. Talk about bending wood. And why do you bend wood? Well, you can achieve forms that you can't do otherwise. There's strength in bent wood, whereas if you take a piece of wood and you cut it, like on a bandsaw, you go across grain, that's a very weak joint, and you can solve that with bent wood. You can use the same wood for different elements of your project. And a curve is more pleasing to the eye. Okay, there are certain kinds of wood that are better at bending than others. The first and foremost is wood that's split. This is a furrow, and this is what they use to split out wood for making chairs, like Windsor chairs.
What's it called?
A furrow, F-R-O-E. It's used like this with a mallet, but the idea is the wood bends, the wood shears along the grain as opposed to being cut, and so it's more likely to be forgiving when you bend it. Quarter sawn works pretty well, and the wider growth range we found are a lot easier, and base grain doesn't work at all. We've tried a couple of different examples of base grain. This is a leftover piece of flooring, and you just can't bend it. The edge grain works much better. There is a list out there, and this I get this from a video I have on bending wood, and the best kind of wood to bend is ash. Unfortunately, Larry and I, neither of us had any ash. Red oak works pretty well, walnut does. Larry had some things here done out of walnut. What doesn't work is softwoods. Unfortunately, that's what was in my burn pile. Figured woods don't work very well. Barrels don't work very well. Knotty wood, in fact, some of the examples I have is wood that has knots in it. And you'll see that they're not very forgiving when they're bent. And for some reason, maple isn't a very good wood to bend. So the different kinds of bends, you can do heat, you can do bent laminations like Bob did there. Hoops, that's what you'd do for a chair back, like a Windsor chair. Or you can do what's called commonly called a coffin kerf, which is what this is. It's just a series of kerfs in a piece of wood, whether it's plywood or solid wood. This is commonly used for, you've got a circular staircase, and at the landing, you want to have the wood go around it. That's what they would use that for. And it got its name from the fact that a long time ago, when they used to build coffins, this is how they got the coffin paper. But they used to use fire to do that, which is problematic, as Larry and I have discovered. Oh, okay, thank you. So you can also use heat to bend wood. And I've got some examples here of where we were doing some boiling thin strips to soften the wood. And you can use a torch, which is a lot of fun. You can use bending forms or a steam box, which Larry and I have discovered was also problematic. It takes a lot of energy to steam bend things. There are a couple of issues here when you bend wood that the outside of the wood is under tension and the inside of the curve is in compression. Wood will compress, but it doesn't stretch. And so you often see failures on the outside, and one of the ways to get around that is what they call a clamping call. Because there's a natural equilibrium somewhere between the outside and the inside where the wood's not going to fail. And by putting a clamping call, you not only reinforce the outside, but you move that point of equilibrium farther out.
What is a clamping call?
A clamping call is a piece of formica. If you watch videos on people that do large bends, they'll have a steel band. And they often have something welded to the end of the steel band, and they use a come along or something.
Okay.
If you're bending something really big.
So are they spreading the tension? Is that what they're doing?
It's providing a backing, so it reinforces the backside of the wood where it will tend to fail.
We'll get into that, Steve. We'll get into that more.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we'll get into that.
Question, does it make a difference if the wood is green or air dried or not yet kiln dried?
Kiln drying is the worst.
Okay.
Air dried is better, but green wood you can also bend too. In fact, a lot of chair makers use green wood. Not only is it easier to bend, but when you assemble the chair and it dries, the joints will naturally shrink. So that's how, in a Windsor chair, when you put the stretchers on the legs, you force them in, and the leg will shrink, and it will shrink around the tenon. So that's an advantage of using green wood. Green woods in this tool are commonly used in chairs. And as I said, when you use a clamping call, the tension on the outside of the curve is going to be the point of failure. And then you'll see that a lot. Bending is an art, not a science. And more often than not, and Larry and I know this firsthand, you can experience a lot of failures. So you've got to be prepared that your first piece may not work. And you don't know it doesn't work until you get right around to the very end and it cracks. And it cracks on the obvious, it cracks on the show side, outside, you know, so. One of the other issues to deal with is spring back, and I've got an example here I can show you, and that when you bend the wood around a form, and then you let it sit and the glue dries overnight, and the thing about gluing is, you have to understand that under normal circumstances, when you glue a piece of wood, 30 minutes later, you take the clamps off. When you bent that wood, you don't take the clamps off in 30 minutes because it's under tension and it'll fly apart. Don't ask me how I know. But when the glue is dry, the wood will naturally relax some, so you have to overbend it. And really, it's not easily predictable how much it's going to spring back. So you generally have to just overbend your wood a little bit. But even with wood that's been bent, it has some give to it. So if you've got a piece that's tight fitting, you can generally get around that spring back if you're careful. One of the first things we did, the easiest thing, is bent laminations. And I've got a form here that we can show. And this is just a cheesy old piece of pine that came out of my burn pile. And I just cut it up into strips, and then we cold bend it, much like Bob did there. His is much more showy than ours. So we bend it around a form, and I use these little wedges that they sell at Home Depot, because their tapered wedges are really good. But next slide. Okay.
God, he works quick.
Yeah, right. Right. There's also a dog in the background. I have to take the dog out somewhere. This is the old part that set his sleeves on fire too. Almost. And if Buzz can focus in here, turn this around. This is an example of spring back, where you can see this was tight around
That's a little bit, you don't do anything to that, but just put it in there?
Just put it in there. No, it's just thin strips of wood, glue is spread, and then you clamp it around a form. Now, you have to treat the form, otherwise, you know, you can glue your work to the form and it ain't gonna come off.
Is there a magic thickness that works the best?
It depends on the wood, but we were going for something that's less than a 1/16 of an inch.
Wow.
So you gotta have a good resaw blade on your bandsaw to cut things. You know, if you got a sander like they've got at Rob's, you could make these kind of things and make them much better, because your joints are gonna be tighter. This is just sawn wood, so if you look at it, you can see the laminations in it.
What do you do to the form so the glue doesn't stick to it? What do you do to the form so the glue doesn't
stick
to it?
This just has polyurethane on it. You can wax it, you can use, some people use packaging tape. You can use wax paper. The problem with wax paper is it tends to get in the joint, and now you've got either something that's open to joint up or something you really have to work to peel off. So we can pass that around if you want to. As I said, you know, bent laminations are common in chairs. You can get a form and a pleasing appearance in a chair that you can't get otherwise. So, you know, it's a common attribute there. You get a lot more strength out of bent laminations than you do out of something that was just saw cut. As I said, you got to wax your form or you got to polyurethane it. And one of the things Larry and I discovered, you have to have your clamps at the ready, and it takes a lot of clamps to get things closed up. And it really comes down to how do you make your bending form? Because where was the other one? We have that. Anyway. Bending around a form is problematic because you have to be able to plan ahead, and that was the thing that we didn't do, is you have to have a place to put your clamps, and you can't clamp like that. So you've got to have notches cut in this. You really have to have thought this through, which is probably what Bob did there, so that you've got a place to clamp things. Because if you watch people that do this and they do it successfully, they'll have a couple dozen clamps in a very small area. And the idea is if you look at that piece there that I'm passing around, there's a lot of gaps in that. Some of which the fact is it's just a cheap piece of pine and it has a knot in it. So that's gonna be a problem too. Glues, you can use, we use yellow glue for a lot of ours. There's an issue though with open time on yellow glue. The best if they do this, if you're doing this commercially, they use urea formaldehyde, which is a powdered glue that you mix. A little more expensive, but it has a longer open time. And the advantage to that is when it dries, it's harder. Yellow glue tends to slip, even once it's dry, because it tends to stay gummy. So things don't always come out. And then I'll show this piece around here when we get to that point. And that you can see the glue seams because the yellow glue is hard to get rid of once it seeps out. One of the things that we did glue was when we boiled the wood, knowing that the yellow glue wasn't going to work with wet wood, we used Gorilla Glue, polyurethane, which brings around its own set of problems. But those are the three different basic kinds of glue that you can use. On something like this, I've seen people use Bondo on the backside. Because basically, what you're trying to do is to fill in the kerf and get it to stay in a given form. So you can use Bondo. But we didn't have it, so we didn't do it. And now this was one of the things you can do, is if you had something like a handrail on your house or something, and you had molding that you couldn't reproduce once it was, that you couldn't reproduce. So you take that piece of molding and slice it on a bandsaw, and then bend it and glue it back together. You know, it's easy enough to do. You just draw your reference marks on the bottom so you know which piece is first. The problem is you've got to have the clamps that match the female form. Otherwise, you can't put enough pressure on it. This was done in this thing. Actually, we used a screwdriver, so that's too thick. Anyway, that was just bent like that, with two screwdrivers on there. It's just an example of what, this was just an old piece of quarter round that I have, but it's hard to get a clamp on a profile and get the clamp to stick. So you can pass that around. But it can be done. Now Bob was telling me on this, he routed that profile after he bent it, which is the best way to do it. But if you don't have, if you're doing like a handrail or something in the house, and you don't have the shaper cutter to do that, you can do this way. It's just, there's a lot of work involved.
Different wood.
Hey Jim, before you move on, so if you have like say a long piece and you're trying to make a long curve and you know you can't do it all at once because it's too extreme, do you just glue a portion of it and bend that and then separate it and glue the next section after it's bent for a while?
Yes.
Or do you have to do it all at once?
You have to do it all at once because there is a, I don't know if we have an example around here or something, where the butt end of the wood is open. It may be that piece. The piece that Jerry's got in his hand. You can see the butt end on that is open, it's not glued. Once that is bent like that and glued, you'd have a real hard time getting glue spread inside the joint. Now they do a lot of kerf joints for splicing wood together. You could conceivably do that, but it's going to be a weak point. But the idea is, and one of the things Larry and I found out is, when you start this process, and you start bending wood, you really need to have your act together. And this was just two old guys in my garage, you know, playing around. And we learned a lot about the shortcomings. Not the least of which is setting yourself on fire. Setting yourself on fire. Okay.
I want to see the video on that
one. Oh, we didn't get that.
Oh man.
Anyway, so this is Larry's handiwork. You know, it's Larry's. I'm more winging it. Just going to show you what you can do. Larry did this kerf cut. And there's a lot of different things you can do with this. This can be bent a fairly substantial amount. Clancy bench lives on. And that you can veneer this either before or after. There are issues associated with, especially if you use plywood, the grain direction of the laminates and the plywood. Just how much you can do. See what I'm saying? Because, sorry, Larry. Anyway, so you just about have to cut all the way through. The other thing is, you should moisten the backside of the wood so it's slightly relaxed.
This was cut on a radio arm saw, very easy. You just set up a mark, quarter inch out, zap, 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 and you dump the curve real quick.
Yeah.
This was an arm off a bench we did recently that was modified slightly to give you a curve, just for an example. So the Clancy bench lives on.
You clamp that on cold?
Yeah, that's just cold.
And when you take the clamps off, will it remain like
you
that?
You have to put something in the curve to solidify it. That's one of the reasons some people use Bondo, because it can be spread in there. This is backwards to do that. But if it was around the other way.
Their recommendation actually is this is in reverse. The part that you want to save should be against the form.
That's correct.
That's all right. So you can fill the back. Right? This way makes it awful hard to fill. So it actually should be on this side of the form so you can fill the back.
What if you on that instead of putting the filler in it? If you just laminated another piece of veneer on the back side.
You could conceivably do that.
I mean, I know it would be strong or whatever.
The veneer would have to be pretty thin.
Yeah.
They also recommend hot glue. How do you actually work?
Yeah.
Anything
you
build
it. You can use hot glue. You can use urethane. Like I said, you could use Bondo. The veneer would work, but I think you'd have to have several layers. You'd have to start with a veneer that you've wet down, and then you glue that on, and then you do another one. Because basically what you're trying to do is build up a piece of plywood.
Yeah.
So the question was, could you use veneer over that? It also would be problematic because you've got clamps everywhere, and how would you get the veneer under the clamps?
Yeah. The other thing is that those curves tend to telegraph through, even on the face side. So when you do that, sometimes if you look in houses, you can actually see vertical striations in the wood on the stairways, and that's what it is. It's the kerf in the wood that's telegraphing through, because that part of the wood is not expanding and contracting as the rest of it is. with the kerf cut here, there's little or no spring back, but the kerf does telegraph through. Use Bondo, and you can use contact adhesive with a veneer on the show side. So you could start with a piece of plywood, or they do this with hardwood. But you have to have the right cut of wood. And as I said earlier, face grade don't work very well. So if you're going to take a piece of wood, like a 3/4 inch piece of oak, and you're going to try to do this with it, what you're doing is you're bending the face grade, and it will fail. So, in fact, it's kind of interesting. You watch the woodworking shows often enough, and you'll see about 9 times out of 10, they do this, and just about the time they're finished, you hear the wood crack. And they say, start over. Anyway, one of the things we've discovered about bending wood is you get a lot of do-overs. Because the first one doesn't necessarily work out.
Don't you need to dampen all the wood before you try to bend?
Say what?
Don't you need to dampen it?
Some you do, some you don't. One of the pieces I sent around, not that one, but the other one, it was just bent cold. And I think that's what you said you did there. Just cold. If you bend it thin, if you cut it thin enough, then you could do this. But you have to bend it, you have to cut it thin enough. This is the ideal kind of thing to have if you've got like a drum sander or something. Because doing this with a bandsaw is hard to get consistent pieces.
Yeah. What species is that?
This is Wigtown Boot. Ivory maple.
Which is not supposed to be good.
I don't know. I don't know. It comes from Paraguay, and I know little or nothing about it. It's a nice wood. It smells bad. When you machine it, it smells bad. It smells like rotten egg. It has funny grain to it that Tommy and I determined was stressed when the tree grows. Because you look at it, and it's not curly, and it's not tiger maple, but you can see where that tree, when it grew, it was under a lot of stress. There's a funny grains in that. So I don't know how well it would bend. But it does, you know, other than that, it's a nice piece of wood. One of the areas we had more success with, once you have your act together, was just bending with hot plates, no fire involved, and a pan full of water, and some thin strips of wood you drop in there. And it'll steam up. I think there's a video here shortly. Okay, this is using heat. So we've got a hot plate, and we've got our thin strips of wood in water. It does take a lot of water. One of the things we have discovered is you need to use distilled water, because tap water will stain your wood. So if you're woodworking, you really need to have a gallon of distilled water in your shop, because even wiping the glue off, tap water will stain wood. So this is just watching water boil. And then this is where we have problems trying to figure out how to bend this thing.
So you're trying to bend it while it's still hot?
Yeah, you bend it while it's hot. And there's a reason why we used urethane glue, because this wood is wet and it's hot. And the thing that we know is you don't have a lot of working time. The glue open time is the least of your problems, because you get hot wood out of a steamer, you got like 15 seconds to position it before it cools to the point where it will no longer bend. And then, you know, if you got this long piece of wood you took out of your steamer and now it looks like that, it's not going to go back into your steamer. So now what are you going to do?
We thought it'd be neat to bend this around a golf ball. As you saw, that didn't work. There's no planting space. There was nothing to do plant it to. So we moved back to this form. And tell them what we discovered about. We put pegs in this form so it would line up nice. So in the middle of gluing this up, our wood example, wherever it may be, the wood's longer than the form. We put it in the form, it wouldn't fit because we now have pegs here. So you can see here, we had to get the saw out in the middle of the wet process, cut off the pegs, and then use the form.
This is what we did. Larry quickly recovered, and once we modified this, and he had glue on there, one of the things we found out was glue is slippery, and you notice that the veneer is no longer where it's supposed to be. So you're trying to get this in here, and this form did work pretty well because you could put clamps on it. And you could get a lot of clamping pressure on this, and it worked real well once we modified the form. So this was one of our better successes in terms of shape. We can pass that around.
Would that form be, after a little while, cause you a problem because it's particle board?
Oh, this was just what I had.
I'm just saying, because it would just soak up that water.
This was all polyurethane.
I know you got it. We've sealed a polyurethane and waxed it, so it's pretty water impervious.
Yeah.
But we're not doing hundreds of them.
But if you were doing something, you know, like Bob did here, you'd really want to spend the money and build your forms such that they were not only precise, but they allowed you to clamp. They had places for the clamps, and you'd also want to either put tape on them or wax them or polyurethane or whatever. It doesn't take much to keep the glue from sticking, but you got to do something. Otherwise you have a mess on your hands. Anyway, So then this is what happens when you have to modify your form. You have to find a saw that some people noticed and others didn't. Anyway, pitfalls. Well, we really tried to make that handle. There was a picture of that Larry had, and he wanted to make one of those. And I had this idea, we bend it over a golf ball, which probably would have worked had we had a better bending form. But just clamping it over a golf ball, you can't get enough clamps on it. And the clamps wanted to tend to slide around. So it was miscalculated is the best way to put it. So you can bend with heat, you can bend with steam, and you can bend with a torch. Torch bending, this was one of our, in the grand scheme of things, more successful bends.
If you don't count the fire.
Yeah, if you don't count the fire. First thing I will tell you, if you're like me, and you got a 30-year-old propane torch laying around, main torch laying around, throw it away, the O-rings on this thing failed. So we had this laying up here, and the next thing Larry and I look over, and there's a big old ball of fire right here. Not just coming out this end, but coming out of the nozzle, coming out of the valve. And the O-rings had failed. So when you laid the torch,
And it looked just like
that. I had a fire extinguisher, but it was on the other side of the room. So I just put it out. I just put it out with a glove. But so this was probably our most successful, albeit most dangerous, because there's a little video in here showing. So we have our torch like that, and this is just a piece of handrail out of shower, and you could get different sizes. One of the things you will see. Larry has a picture that, and you can see this if you watch YouTube videos, you'll see these experienced woodworkers telling you how to build a guitar. And they're standing right in front of this thing, and there's an invisible blue flame about that long. And then that blue flame is aimed right at your zipper. And so, you know, right? So you watch Larry and I did it. We tried to stand out of the way, except for the fire. Anyway.
Well, do you hold it? You hold it in the flame, or do you hold
no,
it?
No, you hold the pipe? It. The flame eats the pipe. You notice the pipe is all discolored, and then you run the wood. It's best if you dampen it, and it's best if you have a bigger piece. You know, we had only these small ones, but these turned out pretty well. Just as examples. The first, yeah, and later on that day, this is what we ended up with. We ended up with a guitar. But for people that build guitars one-off, this is one way to do it. But you've got to have different size pipes. You've got to have the right kind of wood. You've got to have it, this is often mahogany or some other better wood. You moisten the wood before you start. Now, in this particular case, you can bend just one and let it cool and come back and bend the other, because each individual bend in this is done with a different heat cycles. Now, commercially, when they make guitars, they do it all at one time, and they have heat blankets. Basically, the silicone rubber sheets that have heaters in them. And they're already in form, and they just clamp the wood together, and you end up with something like that after about 30 seconds. But there's a commercial version of this that's electric, that's not so exciting. This was too small, and the torch was too hot. So you can see how hot this thing got, and you can see that it burned the clamp that holds it to the thing. So, you know, it did an okay job, just for demonstration purposes.
Jim, did you have to get the wood wet before you put it
yes,
on?
Yes, we did.
Okay, that's
what I thought. Just spritz it.
Is yeah. there a right
temperature
your pipe should be at? Warm enough to bend the wood, not hot
probably,
enough.
Probably so.
It wouldn't turn blue.
Well,
the heat
would turn too hot.
our pipe did get red, at which point we turned the torch down.
Yeah, well, we started out with a torch that was, had, you know, a starter on it. Well, there was no way to adjust the gas on it. It's just going full bore all the time, and it got too hot. So then I switched to one of these. It turned out to be too old, and then we switched to this one, and you can throttle the gas back down. It basically allows you to somewhat diminish the temperature of the pipe. But this pipe is too short, and it's too narrow in diameter. This would have been better with an electric heater or something in it. It's all in. This was the veneer that we're bending. So,
are you going to go over the box down here?
Yeah, Larry's going to get into that. Okay, so that's all there is. That's all there is on hot pipe bending. And this is the easiest to do, albeit the most dangerous.
Okay. Yeah, go ahead. So the next step we have is steam. Three things learned about steam. It's hot. Takes a lot of energy to generate the steam in the steam box. You can use LP gas or you can use electric. In this case, I'll run both. This is a wallpaper steamer that you can get as a kit from...
That's a rocker.
This is a wallpaper steamer that has a rocker kit. It worked fairly well. When you buy the steamer, they also give you instructions to make the steam box. The steam box was owned by Tom Beal, and he loaned it to us. So the first time we saw it, after working with it for a while, we know, I'm bringing it up on the counter. We learned some things about the steam box too. You'll notice that it's facing downhill, so any condensation comes back out this end. This door needs to be a little bit more waterproof. Steaming warped it. It's a pretty long box. If you put short pieces in it, you have a problem getting them back out.
Watch your leg.
And these are the pieces we're actually steaming. They're walnut, and we had to cut the knots out of them because the knots broke. And the third thing is, you need some long tongs. Because if you stick your hand in the steam box, the steamer is at 220 degrees.
212.
My thermometer here says between 210 and 220, somewhere through there. We know steam is 212. That's all right. It depends on barometric pressure.
Yeah.
So there's no blue lines in steaming. You can use an LP tank or 5 gallons of water, 1 hour per half inch, and that's probably a pretty good rule of thumb. We let it steam a little longer because the physical size of this box means for the steam to get all the way down here to my pieces, it took some time to heat the whole box up. And the spring back is unpredictable. And you should always steam more pieces than you want. So what I did, you can use any hardwoods. We gave you a chart earlier on of the hardwoods you can use. And decided the shape you want. We were going for this little handle right here I saw on the web. I thought that would be a really nice item if you can see it. So here's the steamer in my kitchen. My wife appreciated that. We also learned that after you steam or convert water to steam, as it cools, what does it do? It converts back to water. So since it's draining out this side of the steam box, you need to put a pan under it. Otherwise, your wife comes down to her bedroom slippers and she's upset.
There's water on my floor.
The floor got mopped. Just clean your floor now.
Your leg's holding again.
So here is my my tile floor, and then I'm not going to go through all this, but I made a form quickly in the shop, steamed it for roughly 2 hours and put it in the form. Before I get to that, let me go to the next step. They have this type of steamer. There are also various other types. Here is a stove pipe with an end on it that you could easily convert to a steamer. All you need would be this fitting, right? And you'd want to insulate this because although it contains the steam well, heat transfers, of course, and the pipe's going to get hot. Or if you want to steam really long pieces, there is a picture of a guy on the web that has long pieces, and he just puts them in a plastic bag like this, letting the steam permeate the bag and his piece of wood. So 2 hours after I put my slats in the steamer, I opened the door, reached my hand in, and decided I need to go get some tongs.
So does he have anything in there to set that wood on?
If you look at the steamer, there are holes right here, and these are dowel rods across the, there's a rack in there. And if I was going to build another steamer, I'd put two racks in there so I could stack them one above the other rather than one long piece. So I took the piece out of the steamer after 90 minutes, made a real quick form in the garage, and put the piece in the form. And that was at midnight last night. They recommend you keep this in the rack for a couple days, but we're going to see what happens when I take it out today.
What is that black strip right there?
This is insulation.
No, along the length of it.
Insulation.
Gaskets.
So just to keep the steam.
Oh, gasket, yeah.
So here's the piece that I steamed last night. It does match the form. The form is really rough, but that was in the steamer for an hour. It's been drying for about 12. And you can see it's already fractured along the top, and I had to cut the knots out of it.
You know what the insulation strip is made of or whatever?
This is all part of their kit, I believe. The one you buy, Rockler sells a kit, a steamer kit with this wallpaper steamer. It all comes together. But this just looks like just little pieces of black rubber that they've stapled to the box as gaskets. The end, we also found the ends of the pieces you're steaming should be painted. It helps the steam stay in the piece. It doesn't go out through the sails on the end of the wood. And we discovered distilled water is the best thing to use. The steamer will recycle the water, so you can always take the water, pour it back in the steamer, and use it again. I filtered it through a paper filter so that all the resin from the pine and so forth would be out of it and just recycle the water. And drying time is in days, not hours. That's been drying for 12 hours. You can see it's not dry, but the form is still there. And we learned that, what did I learn? Steam is hot. It just looks, you know, it's like a little cloud coming out of the end of the steamer. Put your hand in it, it's hot. And you should, again, be ready, have some tongs ready to get the pieces in and out. These were cheap at the local supermarket. And steamers leak because water condenses, steam condenses back to water, so be prepared to mop up the water, and that's the end of it. Any questions about steam? It was simple.
One of the things we found is that you need a lot of energy. This has got this little wallpaper steamer, which is less than marginal. So what you really need is a 5 gallon can of water and a lobster pot. And you really need to be able to create a large volume of steam.
Or a pressure cooker.
Well, you could use a pressure cooker, yeah, but I'm just saying, it takes a lot.
That's why this box to me was not practical.
Yeah.
amount of steam that I had generated and filled the whole box up. If the box had been this half this size, these pieces would have steamed the whole lot quicker. You had a question there in the back?
Yeah. Did you try to compensate the spring back by cutting their curve a little bigger?
Yes, I did.
Or, I mean, a little tighter.
But, again, this is an art, not a science, so we attempt to do that, but at this point, we're just experimenting. I may actually get to the point where I make those handles, and when I make the handles, I'll bring them in and show what they finally look like. But you have to consider there's going to be a spring back. Anything else?
I was going to say, when you're trying to put that baffle in there, if you went down and came back, if you made it into a U, almost a closed U, to be honest with you, it'll work better because I'm doing that now with the compressed air. So what I'm saying, had the steam come in, but had holes all the way, and it was that way the pressure, that it would be equal all the way around.
Any other questions?